Hello and welcome back to the Alexander Rossi Career Series here on BoxBoxBoxGaming with F1 2016. My name is Justin and today we'll be taking part in the fifth round of the 2016 season, the Spanish Grand Prix from the Circuit de Catalunya. So for those of you that missed qualifying, you might actually want to go check that out this time. It was mixed conditions during practice and qualifying once again, sort of similar to Sochi. So this is your opportunity. If you want to go check that out, go click the link down in the description if you want to check out the qualifying. In the qualifying video, there's a timestamp in the description so that you can skip straight ahead to qualifying if you want. And skip the practice sessions. But basically, again, this is your last chance, but I got pole position. I don't know how or why. It was full wet conditions in Q3. I saved myself a set of the wet tires, a fresh set of the full wets for Q3, just in case if it was full wet conditions. Did my best to make it through Q2 on a set of scrub tires. The same tires that I qualified in Q1 on was the same tires that I went on in Q2. And there we are. There's Alexander Rossi on pole position with a 139.858. I was almost a tenth and a half quicker than the two Mercedes, who will be starting this race from right behind me, and it is a very long run down towards turn one. So I'm very, very nervous. My dry pace, my slick tire pace, not so good, not nearly as good. In fact, I was worried about getting out of Q2, to be totally honest, based on the slicks. But here we go. Here's the qualifying. Again, Rossi on pole, followed by Rosberg and Hamilton in second and third, and then Raikkonen in fourth. Then we have Vettel and Verstappen, Ricciardo and Jenson Button, followed by Alonso, actually. Both McLarens making it into the top 10. Then Felipe Massa, my teammate Grosjean in 11th, Sergio Perez, Valtteri Bottas, Daniil Kvyat, Nico Hülkenberg, Carlos Sainz, Julian Palmer, Kevin Magnussen, Ericsson, Harry Anto, Felipe Nasr, and Pascal Wehrlein. Again, bringing up the rear of the grid. I swear, Pascal Wehrlein has been last for like almost every single race we've had so far this season. So because of the wet weather conditions in Q2, it does mean that I have free choice of tires. The recommended strategy is going to be a one-stop, starting on the soft compound tires and then switching to the medium compound tires. However, because of the wet weather conditions, it really gives me some options here to play around with. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to take a look and see what I can do. Now, of course, the recommended one is going to say that it's the least amount of time. So you can see, for example, with this strategy where I start on the mediums and then go to the hards, it says projected race time is 9 seconds slower. Any sort of change that I make, it's going to say that it's slower, without a doubt. So it's not super easy to overtake here. Really, there's only one overtaking location, and that is into turn one with the DRS and everything. I'm running 5.5 wings for those of you that did not watch the qualifying video. I didn't feel so good in the corners with 4.4 wings or 5.4 wings. So, and especially with the wet weather conditions, and I didn't know if it was going to be wet for the race. So when I saw in qualifying that it was full wet conditions, I went ahead and upped my rear wing angle to 5 to match the front wing angle of 5 as well. And now I'm thinking about possibly going from the soft compound tires just onto the hards a little bit earlier. So that would be kind of an undercut. Is what I'm thinking about doing, because again, very difficult to pass here. So if anybody comes into the pits before me, they're almost guaranteed to undercut me in the pits. So I'm trying to protect against the undercut as much as I possibly can. And to do that, I'm thinking about doing an earlier stop. See, they want me to do six. It's a 17 lap race. They want me to do 6 laps on the softs, 11 laps on the mediums, but I'd like to come in a little bit earlier than that and go onto the hard tires. So it says that this is 5 seconds slower than the strategy that they've recommended to me, but it would mean that I can come into the pits on lap 4 and then go to the end of the race on the hard tires. So that is going to leave me vulnerable towards the end of the race, as I'm going to be on worn hard tires, which is, of course, going to be quite a bit slower versus the mediums. But again, this is going to allow me to undercut people, come into the pits before them, come out on a fresh set of the hard compound tires, and hopefully build enough of a gap to where people won't undercut me when they come in for the medium compound tires. I doubt we'll see any two stops. This would be one of those races where you actually could see some two stops, but I doubt we'll see any of that. We had some issues getting off the line. I was kind of confused from pole position and kind of first time on pole, so I wasn't really sure what was going on. So Rosberg actually got off the line ahead of me, but I was able to catch up to him and pass him. So starting the race on these soft compound tires, and then we're going to be going on to a set of the hards until the end of the race, and we'll see what we can do. Now, my goal for the race, I believe, is sixth position, so I can lose five positions and still finish ahead of my target position of sixth, or at my target position of sixth. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to do my absolute best. I'm going to defend like crazy. I mean, and that's the thing, you know, I'm going into this race and knowing that I'm pretty much going to be defending the entire time. I mean, who am I going to be attacking? There's nobody ahead of me. And once the Mercedes or Ferraris or even the Red Bulls get ahead of me, there's really not anything I can't do. There's nothing I can do to catch back up with them. I have pretty good pace through Sector 1, decent pace through Sector 2, and then Sector 3 is just garbage. I'm just terrible through Sector 3. So, which is unfortunately the sector right before the DRS zone where the overtaking location is. So we'll see how things go. It's a relatively low downforce setup, so I'm not going to be the easiest car on the grid to overtake, but certainly, you know, if I was running lower downforce wings, then it would be just that smidgen bit harder for everybody else into our grid position. But it's going to be a very long wait, of course, as we wait for the rest of the grid. Just talking about Romain Grosjean quickly, I do believe that was his best qualifying position in 11th position. He nearly made it into Q3, but just couldn't quite do it. But he's in a good position to pick up some points here as well. As we got a double points finish last time out in Russia. Link to that video down in the description below as well if you missed Russia. It was a great race, probably the most exciting race that we've had so far this season. But here we are on the grid in the Haas as Alexander Rossi. We've got five lights, engines left revving, and we're away. We're going to go straight into the replay camera so that you guys can see what's going on. Nico Rosberg already alongside us, and in fact pulling away. Lewis Hamilton now alongside us, three wide into turn one. It looks like Nico Rosberg has the measure of both of us. I'm going to go side by side with Lewis Hamilton, possibly some light contact there, and both Mercedes cars are already ahead of me after turn one. So there go the Mercedes. Bye, have a great time. And the two Ferraris are just hounding me, and then the Red Bulls are right behind them, so things are not off to a great start. We've already lost two positions down into third. We're still in a podium position, but the fact that I've lost two positions already and we didn't even make it through Sector 1 is not a good sign for sure. So gonna have to be worrying about the red cars, the Scuderia behind me. Those guys are certainly going to be very quick as well. Not quite as quick as the Mercedes drivers, but We'll keep an eye out on those guys and see what we can do. Again, coming into the pits at the end of lap four for a very early pit stop. So hopefully, even if they do jump me, if I could just keep up with them a little bit and then have a really good in and out lap, that will possibly allow me to jump back in front of them. So it looks like one of the McLaren drivers actually was able to jump one of the Red Bulls, surprisingly enough. I'm not sure who that is, but we've got who I believe is Kimi Raikkonen. I believe Kimi Raikkonen is the car that's directly behind me, coming to the end of lap number one now. And of course, no DRS activated yet, so I don't have to worry too much just yet about the Ferraris overtaking me. But look at that, Raikkonen in the slipstream, picking up a hell of an amount of speed, and actually going around the outside of us at turn number one. I'm going to leave him the space in turn two, and he's actually done it. Kimi Raikkonen makes the overtake at the outside of turn one, inside of turn two, and I've just got no response for him whatsoever. I'm in rich mix, even using lots and lots of rich mix on lap one and in lap two, and that was my plan. I was going to use as much rich mix as I possibly could and really punish these soft compound tires. The fact that I'm coming in so early for my pit stop means that I can push like hell on these soft compound tires and then switch to the hard compound tires later on. So I'm going to be pushing like hell here. I'm going to be using lots of rich mix. If I need to do some fuel saving later on, I can do that in Sector 3. Sector 3 is a great place to do some fuel saving at this circuit, so that is my plan at the moment. Now, Sebastian Vettel right behind us, tucked into the slipstream, into the turn 10 braking zone, and it looks like we're going to hold him off for now. DRS activated at the end of this lap. However, the DRS detection line is before the start-finish line, so the first opportunity that Vettel will have with DRS will be on the back straight in between turns 9 and 10. So I should be safe. Now, I should have been safe last lap, too, and Kimi Raikkonen just went flying by me. So we'll see how this works out as we make our way down towards turn number one for the third time in this race. Again, 17-lap race on this 25% distance and into the braking zone. No problems this time. Don't have to worry about Vettel pulling alongside. So we are safe from the German at the moment. But, yeah, it's not going super well at the moment. We are still in fourth position, but again, not even three laps completed so far. So it certainly could have been going better. I would have liked to have been in at least second or third at this stage, but I'm still ahead of Vettel, so I will take it. Making our way out of turn 5, through the turn 6 kink, and into the 7 and 8 chicane now. Third gear for that one, a bit of the inside curb, and just a smidgen of the outside curb as well. Downshift and a brake, actually, a stab of the brakes and a downshift into 5th gear for turn number 9, the uphill right-hander. And yeah, Vettel closing down with that DRS, but not able to get alongside or anything like that as we head into sector 3 at the end of lap number 3. So coming into the pits next lap, or is this lap 4 now? I've already forgotten. That's the downside to showing these exterior replay cameras, is that I have no idea what lap number we're on. But yeah, no, that is the end of lap number 3, so we are staying out. And however, Sebastian Vettel is going to be getting DRS on the very long start-finish straight here on the run down towards turn number 1. Let's see, can he do anything? We can see the wings all open on all of these cars, everybody picking up DRS except for me and probably Nico Rosberg as well, or whoever's currently leading the race, whichever of the two Mercedes. I have to say, I pretty much handed the win to the Mercedes cars, though, as they went flying by very early on in the race, and I've been holding up the two Ferraris, or I held up the two Ferraris for a little while before Raikkonen got by, and now I'm holding up the second Ferrari of Sebastian Vettel as well. So I'm definitely helping out the Mercedes cars here, as they should have no problem finishing 1-2 with the Ferraris pretty much out of this race. Those Mercedes guys pulled out a hell of a gap by the time Raikkonen had got by me, so it's looking pretty good for them to pick up a 1-2 finish here today at the Spanish Grand Prix. Excuse me, at the end of lap number 4, the gap to Sebastian Vettel. Oh, we've got a huge engine failure in the background there. I can tell you that is Max Verstappen with a huge, huge engine failure there, giving up the ghost coming out of turn number 9 on the rundown towards that turn 10 hairpin. So Max Verstappen is out of this race. Unfortunately, that did not cause a safety car or anything. A safety car would have been nice because I was about to come into the pits anyway. And that would have allowed me to have a shot at coming back at Raikkonen and the two Mercedes. Now, I'm 99% sure that I have the safety car turned on, but yeah, I don't know. I guess he was able to get to the side of the track and prevent any sort of safety car. So you can see here we come into the pits at the end of lap number 4. We're going to go into the hard compound tires, and then we're going to be doing the remaining 13 laps of this race on that set of hard compound tires. Thankfully, nobody else in the pits, so it's a nice smooth pit stop for the Haas team. And coming out, and you can see just how empty it is. It is completely empty. Nobody near us whatsoever. So I will get to push here, and I am going to use a lot of rich mix as well. You can see I'm in rich mix down at the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. And again, I'm going to push like hell here and try to maybe undercut Sebastian Vettel, who is all over the back of us. I was way too far back from Kimi Raikkonen, so there's nothing I'm going to be able to do about him. Nothing doing. He's gone. The Mercedes boys as well. Excuse me. Sorry, I'm recording this commentary at 9:30 in the morning before work. I woke up nice and early, got some caffeine in me, and I'm doing this commentary before work so that I can render the video, get this uploaded for you guys ASAP. So yeah, making our way into Sector 3 now. Breaking around the 100 meter board down into second gear for the turn 10 hairpin, missing my apex ever so slightly, but again, pushing very, very hard here. Really want to have a good in-lap and out-lap. I'm not sure how good my in-lap was, but my out-lap seems to be going pretty decently here. As I come out of Sector 3, I fully expected that I'll be putting it into Rich Mix for the long run down to Turn 1, taking a little bit too much curbing there at the entrance of the chicane. So that is going to lose me a little bit of time, and making the run down, is anybody in the pits yet? It does not look like anybody is in the pits. Yep, so that's a little bit worrying. I'm not going to lie, everybody's still out there on the set of tires that they started the race on, and I did indeed go into Rich Mix, and I will stay in Rich Mix for Turn 3 here, and the run down towards Turn 4, I imagine, as well. Picking up speed all the way down here, braking just before hitting 180 miles per hour, and down into third gear, and trying not to let the car run out too wide there, but unfortunately getting some oversteer as a result of that. Missing my apex slightly for turn number 5. Not a big deal, though. When you miss your apex for a hairpin ever so slightly, it's not the end of the world. It's worse for corners like this if you miss your apex in comparison to hairpins, so not the worst thing that could ever happen to me. Missing my apex, though, for turn number nine, that's certainly not going to be helping. And I am starting to close in significantly. Nasser ahead of us was about 8 seconds up the road as I came out of the pits, and now he's just 5 seconds up the road. So at least I'm 3 seconds quicker than Felipe Nasser over the course of basically one lap. So I'm catching up to those guys on their worn soft compound tires, and looking at the minimap, is anybody going into the pit lane? It looks like, yes, at least two cars going into the pits at the end of lap number 6, so I should be moving up to at least P19 here. There we go. In fact, there is way more than two cars in the pits. There's tons of cars in the pits, so we're going to move up into 17th, 16th. Alonso's in 15th. We're going to take Alonso. That's Ricardo now just ahead of us, and then Vettel just ahead of him. So we did nearly protect against the undercut from Vettel. Ooh, a sneaky move on Ricardo there, who was moving very slowly in between turns 2 and 3. So we've been able to gain a position on Daniel Ricardo, who really should have been behind us when we came through anyway. But clearly that Red Bull able to put in faster laps on a set of the worn soft compound tires than I'm able to on a set of the fresh hard compound tires. Again, though, my dry weather condition pace at the circuit was not nearly as good as my wet weather condition pace. So again, for those of you that maybe saw qualifying and were saying, oh yeah, this is too easy now, you need to up it to legend difficulty, I present to you Exhibit A, where I'm getting absolutely destroyed. I mean, Daniel Ricciardo is all over the back of me. And at this point, I'm having PTSD flashbacks to pro season mode, because I had an intense battle with Daniel Ricciardo, and in fact he made contact with me into that turn 10 hairpin, where he was very close to making contact with me just a few corners ago. So I was having flashbacks to that moment where Daniel Ricciardo took me out basically at the Spanish Grand Prix when I was driving as Alonso in the 2015 pro season series. We've got a car up ahead coming out of the pits. Daniel Ricciardo with the DRS is going to be possibly having to look into turn 1. No, not quite. We were able to brake late enough so that we were able to take the racing line through there. And it is actually a McLaren ahead of us. So they've actually overcut me by staying out longer on the soft compound tires. So far this strategy that I've had has not worked out whatsoever. I think I maybe would have been better off going on to a set of the mediums at the end of lap 4. Trying to build the gap as much as I can, and then just suffering at the end of the race, because this is certainly not working out nearly as well as I would have hoped. So I'm pushing very hard now to try and catch up to the McLaren that's ahead of me. I'm not sure if that's Jenson Button or Fernando Alonso, but I'd really like to get ahead of him as soon as possible, because fantastic angle here looking backwards on the Haas at Daniel Ricciardo with that DRS open. He's getting very, very close. We're into the braking zone now, though, so he's not able to get alongside. But again, really, really like this camera angle. I wish they would do that for every circuit, because I don't think I've seen that camera angle at the other 4 races so far this season. I think Circuit de Catalunya is the first one that I'm actually seeing that rearward-facing camera. Into Sector 3 now. Daniel Ricciardo all over the back of us. And another McLaren just behind him. So we've got a couple of McLarens around us. And that is Jenson Button that's up ahead. So that's Fernando Alonso that's behind Daniel Ricciardo. And Ricciardo has gotten a fantastic exit out of turn 16. He's going to move to the inside line for turn number one. And let's see if he can break late enough to take the position without having to go side by side. No, he can't. We force him into a side by side battle through turn two and into turn three as well. Still side by side. I have to leave him space there. He's still got his wing alongside of me. He's going to have the inside line now for turn number four. I'm going to have to go around the outside of turn five. It looks like I've just about done it. No, some contact there from Daniel Ricciardo, pushing us a little bit wide. That means he's going to have the advantage into turn five. However, some late braking is going to allow us to get the inside line on him and take that position back, as well as Fernando Alonso as well, with an opportunistic move on Daniel Ricciardo to move up ahead of him, which is great because I would much prefer to have Fernando Alonso behind me than to have Daniel Ricciardo behind me. So I am all too happy to have Alonso take that position off of Ricciardo. Once again, that rear view facing camera on this Haas heading into the turn 10 hairpin, and you can see the differing lines that we take. I really try to focus on the exit of that corner rather than the entrance of that corner, and you can see that represented in the lines that we take. So again, up ahead is Jenson Button. He just got by one of the Renault cars, actually, and at this stage I'm pushing very, very hard to try and pick up DRS off this Renault, because that would help me protect against Fernando Alonso behind me. That was the DRS detection line back there. Activation line coming up now. Did I do enough to get the DRS? No, I didn't. Fernando Alonso is going to move to the right-hand side. We're going to be side-by-side heading into turn number one. Daniel Ricciardo as well, just behind with the DRS open, and also with the Williams, again going side-by-side with another car. This time, though, I was able to shoot around the outside of turn one and protect that position, so we didn't have to go side-by-side through turns number two and three. Again, though, we've got this Renault just ahead of us, and if we can get by him as quickly as possible and force Fernando Alonso to have to sit behind Kevin Magnussen for a little bit, that would be fantastic for us. That would allow us to pull out a little bit of a gap. So here we go for a diving move for the second time in this race at the turn five hairpin, and taking that move pretty easily from Kevin Magnussen. And yes, Fernando Alonso is now stuck behind Kevin Magnussen, and he's going to be stuck behind him heading through this chicane. Look at the gap that I'm pulling on that Renault. Button up ahead, meanwhile, has started to pull away. However, he is stuck behind the second Renault of Julian Palmer. Both of the Renaults, I believe, going for an alternate strategy where they started the race on the medium compound tire. So they have yet to pit. They are out of position right now. So essentially, we're in a net eighth at the moment, or at least a net eighth. Because again, Julian Palmer still yet to pit. And we can see actually up ahead, he's doing a fantastic job of holding up Jenson Button for us. Let's hope he does not come into the pits this lap, because I'd really like to see him hold up Jenson's and more. He does not come into the pits. And it looks like behind us, Kevin Magnussen not pitting either. So it's looking pretty good for us to pull out a bit of a gap. And I think I gave Magnussen DRS there as well, so hopefully that will allow him to defend. Looking up at the top left at the names, is Alonso going to get by Magnussen here into turn one? Yes, he does. They're still side by side in the background. Nope, Alonso's done the job. He's up into P10, and as well, Jenson Button now ahead of Julian Palmer up the road. So same as before with Magnussen, though. I'm going to try and get by Palmer as quickly as I possibly can, to make it as difficult for Alonso to get past him as I can possibly do. I mean, I really like Palmer to hold up Alonso just like Magnussen did. You can see Alonso is now starting to get closer now that he's cleared the Renault. But again, we've got another Renault up ahead, so hopefully with that same tactic, we can make it work. Coming to the end of lap 11 now, just six laps remaining in this 17-lap race. Did we pick up the DRS? Yes, we did. We picked up the DRS off of Julian Palmer, so that's going to help us defend against Fernando Alonso behind into the braking zone of the hairpin once again. And we are very, very close to Julian Palmer. I'm not sure if he's going to be coming into the pits. It's very possible that he's coming into the pits this lap, though, to run a six-lap stint at the end of the race on the soft compound tire. So here we go into turn 13, into the 14-15 chicane. And I should pick up DRS here, whether he pits or not. But it's not been a great exit out of the chicane. Palmer does not pit. He's going to stay out for another lap. Alonso, not that far behind us. Do we get the DRS? Yes, we do. DRS open now in the slipstream, in the rich mix as well. And gaining all the time on Palmer. This is now for P7 in this race, up the inside of turn three. Bit of a lockup at the inside wheel. Excuse me. And that is going to move us up into P7 again, though. Button pretty far up the road. So this is looking like about as good as I could possibly do in this race. So far, I got 10th, and then I got 7th, and then I got 6th. So if I could get another 6th here, that would be another 8 points, which would be truly fantastic. I would be very happy with 6, and in fact, in fact, sixth is my target. But again, currently in seventh position as it stands right now. So we'll have to see how that works out. Palmer, though, still holding up Alonso behind us, as you can see in the rearview mirrors. So he is creating a very nice buffer between myself and the Spaniard. So that's going pretty well. I'm happy with how that's going. Dropping it down into lean mix for Sector 3. Again, Sector 3, a fantastic place to do some fuel saving here at the Circuit of Catalunya, since you're really not on the power for very much of Sector 3. Like for this very, very long corner, and then you have a slight straight where you really don't pick up much speed, and then you're braking and turning, and then throttle, and then braking and then turning, and then now we go full throttle once again. So now we'll be upping it into standard mix or possibly rich mix as well as we come into the start-finish straight once again. And we can see in the background, Julian Palmer did go into the pits, releasing Fernando Alonso. So he now has clean air. However, he is coming under attack from Daniel Ricciardo, and it looks like Ricciardo's just about got the move done already. Heading into turn number one, looking in the background, is Daniel Ricciardo ahead? Yes, he is. Daniel Ricciardo up ahead. So now I've got to worry about, instead of Fernando Alonso, I've got to worry about Daniel Ricciardo, which is much worse, in my opinion. Heading into turn number four, early apex, and then getting on the throttle nice and early as well, because it's an increasing radius corner is turn four. It's tighter at the entrance and more open at the exit, so you want to take a very early apex for that corner, of course. And I'm just going to be keeping an eye on that gap to Daniel Ricciardo. I mean, with the speed that I have through Sector 3, or lack thereof, I fully expect Daniel Ricciardo might even pick up DRS on the very next lap as we come across the start-finish line. He's not going to pick up DRS here on the back straight on the rundown towards turn 10, thankfully. It's a 2.2-second gap, and then as we cross the line, it's a 1.6-second gap. So Daniel Ricciardo picking up 0.6 of a second just through Sector 2. And again, Sector 3 is where I'm really, really struggling in this Haas. So unfortunately, Ricciardo is probably going to pick up DRS here. Now, we have moved up into P6, so there was a car into the pits at some point last lap as we finish lap 13, start lap 14, just four laps remaining in the Spanish Grand Prix. And let's see, let's keep an eye on the rear view. And yes, it's less than a second to Ricciardo, but it does not look like he's going to be able to make an overtake attempt into turn number one here. He's just too far back on this particular occasion. However, next lap, I fully expect that I'm going to have to take some defensive action, some defensive maneuvers in order to keep Ricciardo behind. So again, that'll be 15, 16, and 17. So three laps that I'll probably have to defend from Daniel Ricciardo, as we are now up into our target position of sixth. So I would really, really, really like to hold on to this. It's unfortunate, though, that I haven't really made any overtakes in this race. It's pretty much been entirely defending, but that's exactly what I expected this race to be, considering that I started from pole position way, way, way out of position, if we're being totally honest. But man, I was really, really hoping for some rain in this race, because that would have been very, very helpful for me. I really, really would have liked that. Into the turn 10 hairpin, Daniel Ricciardo is extremely close. Yeah, just 0.2 away, so he is definitely going to be picking up DRS. In fact, he did pick up DRS on that back straight here. Coming to the end of lap 14 now. And let's see, what are we going to do? So, of course, if you defend the inside line of turn 1, that becomes the outside line of turn 2, but then becomes the inside line of turn 3. So, do I try and defend the inside line of turn 1 and hope that I can defend, or do I stay to the outside and try to get the inside line for turn 2? Let's see what I do here. I'm staying to the left-hand side. I'm going to let Daniel Ricciardo get the inside line for turn 1. We're going to be side-by-side into the corner. And it looks like, oh, there's been some contact, and Daniel Ricciardo has spun off into the grass. He is not out of this race, but he has lost a significant number of positions as a result of that contact. I can tell you right now, I did not even get a warning for a collision with Daniel Ricciardo there, so I do believe that was entirely his fault. I'm not going to go back and take a look at it from his point of view or anything like that, but I can tell you, I definitely left it the space. I always leave it the space. Always. Excuse me. I'm a very fair driver. You can see I'm trying not to corner cut at turn 7 there. I try to avoid corner cutting as much as I can, or track extending. I try to be as fair about this as I possibly can. So I left Daniel Ricciardo room. He just maybe didn't make the best use of that room. And unfortunately, that put him for a spin at the exit of turn one, entrance of turn two, and he's going to lose a significant number of positions. However, the good news for us, though, now is that the car behind is Fernando Alonso, and there is just two laps remaining in this race. So we'll see what we can do against the Spaniard in his home Grand Prix, of course. So he is going to be buoyed by that, the cheers from the crowd, as it were. And we're using some rich mix on the start-finish straight here. 0.3 off our personal best. Not bad whatsoever, actually, considering we're now on 11-lap old hard compound tires. So the fact that that last lap was only 0.3 off my PB is not bad at all. Alonso was not able to make a move into turn one, so we didn't have to really worry about going side by side with him as we start this penultimate lap of the Spanish Grand Prix, again in P6, but just 0.6 behind us is Fernando Alonso, the two-time world champion in that McLaren Honda. And again, for those of you that missed the practice and qualifying sessions, McLaren have brought some upgrades here to Catalunya. In fact, some significant upgrades. They are not much far slower than the Haas. They are now the sixth fastest team, and the gap between McLaren and Haas is very, very small. Very small indeed. So really not much between the two cars. Excuse me. I do believe I still have the straight line speed advantage on him. However, in the corners, I fully expect that McLaren Honda to be gaining significantly on this Haas. Through sector three now into turn 12, very long turn 12. Kind of reminds me of Luffield at Silverstone, except it's uphill as well, in addition to being a very, very long right-hand corner. Into the chicanes, taking a little bit of inside curb for both of those, a bit of the outside curb as well at the exit of the chicane. Up into rich mix now as we prepare to defend from Fernando Alonso as we start lap number 17, final lap of this race, defending the inside line, heading into turn number one. Alonso's going to have to go around the outside. It looks like he's just about got the move done, but with some late braking, we're able to stay alongside him. We're going to have to go around the outside of turn two. Where is he? Still on the left-hand side. He's got the advantage. We're coming back at him with the inside line for turn number three. However, getting onto the marbles ever so slightly, so he was able to get on the throttle a bit earlier. Side by side once again into turn number four. We've got the inside line, possibly a bit of wheel banging there between the two of us. Now we've got a Force India getting involved as well. That's Nico Hülkenberg on a set of the soft compound tires. So we've got me on the hards, Alonso on the mediums, and Hülkenberg on the softs. And it looks like he's going to make a move now on Alonso. They're going to be side by side into turn number seven, which is fantastic news for me. Alonso's going to stick it around the outside, though, and actually defend that position from the Force India on the soft compound tires. Final lap of this race heading into sector three, and it looks like we've got a decent gap to that McLaren behind us. So it looks like we are actually going to come home in P6. Just need to keep it on the road, not make any sort of mistakes. Not behind, right behind Nico Hülkenberg actually is our teammate Romain Grosjean. So we are on for a double points finish. That would be ninth position for Grosjean, which would be his best finish so far this year. That would be 2 points. He's only got 1 point heading into this race. He's going to triple that points haul after this race if he can just hold on to that ninth place position. Through the final corner as we cross the line, we are going to come home in sixth position after what was a very, very difficult race. extremely, extremely tough. You can see Fernando Alonso obviously very upset as he's decided to overtake us after the checkered flag has fallen. Is it Sharp-Haired Man? Sharp-Haired Man, what's going on? Shaking hands with Toto Wolff. Sharp-Haired Man is excited. And Lewis Hamilton is going to pick up another win here, just making it even closer at the top of the standings. But they do pick up a 1-2. As I mentioned, the two Mercedes cars just getting by me into turn one. And then the fact that I blocked Vettel and Raikkonen for a good period of time really meant that there was nothing that Ferrari could do. So up at the front, unfortunately, I did make the race very boring by blocking those Ferraris. But I'm very happy with sixth position. That's another 8 points for my total. Sat on 16 heading into this race, so that's actually going to put me on 24. Now, worth pointing out, Max Verstappen was on 24 points heading into this race and did actually DNF. So this puts me level on points with Max Verstappen, who has not been having a great season compared to his teammate Daniel Ricciardo, certainly. But it's a very familiar podium, worth pointing out. Hamilton, Rosberg, Raikkonen. That's the podium that we've been seeing pretty much all season long. Raikkonen really had the measure of Vettel so far this year. So again, there's the confirmation. Hamilton ahead of Rosberg by 3 seconds, then a 7-second gap down to Kimi Raikkonen, and another 7 seconds down to Sebastian Vettel. Jenson Button, though, picking up 5th position for McLaren Honda. An incredible drive from Jenson after starting from 8th on the grid. And then Fernando Alonso in 7th. So 16 points for McLaren. Meanwhile, just 10 points for Haas. We are actually ahead of them in the championship, but now I'm not so sure because that is a very nice points haul for them. But yeah, just happy about the double points finish. Glad that Romain Grosjean was able to pick up that 9th place. Bringing up the rear, we could see the only DNF was Max Verstappen. So unfortunate for him. But again, this race went very, very well. I'm happy with how things went. And I almost said looking forward to the next race, and then I remembered what the next race is. Now, the good thing is that for this Monaco Grand Prix, I'll only have to do like 19 or 20 laps, so that's good. But there we see confirmation. I have moved up into 6th in the championship standings ahead of Max Verstappen and Felipe Massa as well. Massa failing to score points in this race, so that's going to move us from 8th up into 6th in the Drivers' Championship. Taking a look down at the bottom, who hasn't scored, and it's Carlos Sainz, the Renaults, the Saubers, and the Manners. So Carlos Sainz having a terrible season, absolutely terrible season. I mean, Kvyat's not doing much better. He's only gotten the 1 point. Sergio Perez only with 2 points, so it's not been great for them. And there we go. McLaren Honda, as I mentioned, picking up a nice haul of points here in Spain, and that's going to move them ahead of Force India and just 8 points adrift of us in the Haas. And we're just 6 points adrift now of the Williams team. So hopefully we can gain some time on Williams and move up into fourth. I think Red Bull, Ferrari, and Mercedes, you know, they're going to be untouchable here in this 2016 season. So I fully expect not to be overtaking them or anything. Now, also worth pointing out, I'm not picking up any sort of upgrades heading into Monaco. The only upgrade that I really would have wanted going to Monaco would have been downforce. And unfortunately, because we've already picked up 2 downforce upgrades, it means that it's like 900 resource points to pick up the next one. So I will not have enough resource points to pick up that downforce upgrade that I would have liked to have for Monaco. So I think Monaco, though, I'm going to be just, you know, I'm going to be running 11-11 wings pretty much. Maybe 11-10, something like that, you know, to help with the straight line speed ever so slightly. But I'm going to be running max downforce, I fully expect, and just trying to get as high up on the grid in qualifying as I possibly can, and then just defend like hell and try not to crash. That's kind of my strategy heading into the Monaco Grand Prix. So that is going to do it. So we went from 1st to 6th. But that was pretty much expected, to be honest. I think everyone expected the Mercedes and Ferrari's cars to jump me in that race. I'll tell you what I didn't expect, though, was for Jenson Button to jump me like that. Jenson in 5th position is a fantastic result for McLaren, and I'm sure those guys are going to be thrilled about that because it's done wonders for their championship. So coming up next time is going to be the Monaco Grand Prix, by far my least favorite circuit on the F1 calendar. I am absolute garbage when it comes to Monaco. It's not going to go well whatsoever, I can tell you. It's going to be one of my worst races of the season, no doubt about it. But I hope you guys enjoyed it. That was a pretty exciting race. Maybe not quite as exciting as Russia. I can't believe I'm saying that. But yeah, Russia was maybe a little bit more exciting. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed that. I certainly did. And I will see you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.